turn here, it makes this move. Comes down. That's how it pulls itself tight. And if it's not all the way open, when you put it on here, it doesn't want to close properly. So if it's like this, you can turn forever and it will not get tight. So we have to turn the outside. You hear it click. Now it's in relatively smooth, and then we go like that to make it tighter. This, again, this was probably drained this morning, so there shouldn't be any water.
Oh!
Oh, too full.
But lots of gas. And the reason we have rats? And then, if you find stuff that's dirty, you can take the gasoline rag you and you can clean the helicopter up again with it. So, no water in that one either. But probably you don't want to fill it up that much. If it does spill a little bit, it's okay. We just clean it up. I don't know why that one's still leaking. If you do get fuel on the plastic, want to wipe it off right away. The rest of it doesn't matter. If this overflows, it comes down onto this tray and then off the back and just drips out. It's designed to keep it away from the engine. Big pieces. Main rotor head, mast, swash plate, transmission. And the transmission, the white thing is attached to the engine. Piston engine, 6 cylinders. 3 on this side, 3 on the other side. Each cylinder has 2 spark plugs. A car usually only has 1 spark plug. This has 2. 1, 2, 3. And then the other ones are on the other side. So we have spark plugs here, spark plug here. So 2 spark plugs for each cylinder. The spark plug wires go to the magnetos. 1 magneto, 2. Magnetos produce electricity to run the spark plugs. So we don't need an engine, we don't need a battery, we don't need a generator for the engine to keep running. These attach to the engine. When the engine is running, the crankshaft turns, it spins inside of here, there's copper windings, and they spin, and they produce electricity. So as long as the engine is turning, if these are working properly, they produce electricity. Each magneto has 1 spark plug for each cylinder. So if we lose 1 magneto, we still have 1 functioning spark plug in each cylinder. So the engine will still run fairly smoothly. We'll lose a little bit of power, but not very much. Now, when it's attached and installed on the helicopter, these are very difficult to see. And they're sealed. There's nothing we can see. There is oil inside, so sometimes they leak. Here, if we find oil on the ground, it's a possibility it might be leaking from there. Nothing that pilots can do anything about. We go find an engineer and we ask him or show it to him. Say, hey, look, magneto's leaking. From the engine, when it runs, turns, the fan turns. This is for cooling of the engine. This is an air-cooled engine. There's no liquid in it, no radiator. So one of the reasons the shroud is here, snaps on, it helps to keep the air around the parts of the engine. This is spun from the transmission. There's a gear inside called the sun gear. It moves this shaft, turns this pulley, turns the belts, which turn the fan. This just bolts onto the engine. It's not turned from here, it's turned from there. We can check the tension of the belts on the helicopter by reaching in and pushing to make sure that they're not too loose. If they're too loose, they slip, we don't get the proper airflow. Got the mounting basket, two bolts, one on either side, and we'll look at them on the helicopter. The transmission is bolted onto the end of the engine. When the engine is running, the crankshaft turns. It turns the shaft inside here, spins everything through the gears, which turns the main mast, and there's splines on the top where the parts are attached. Swash plate. Right? When I move the controls, you can see the swash plate move. The arms get attached in these three places, and they move up and down. And this whole thing will move up and down like this. When the collective moves, when the cyclic moves, the only thing that moves is the swash plate. It tilts. So much easier to see when it's like that. Magnetos. Here's one right here, and the other one over there on the other side. These three wires going that way, so one for those cylinders. These three wires for those. The wiring for the spark plugs in here, here's the cable, and it goes to the other side. Okay. So, magnetos, spark plug wires. We don't want to grab and pull on them, because we pull on the inside and it comes apart and then they don't work anymore, then the engine doesn't start, then we can't fly it. Engine. Here's your belts and the tension. How much should it move? It should move exactly the same amount that it moved yesterday. If it seems a whole bunch different, then we go find one of the guys in the blue suits and we say, hey, that feels different than it did yesterday. And he'll come and push on it and say, no, that's okay. That's okay. That's all right. The shroud is also attached to this. Anybody have any idea what that is? Any guesses?
A filter.
Okay, one guess, a filter.
Cooler something.
Oh, cooler. I like that one better. Yeah, because the air's going to blow through here from the backside out this side. Now, what would it cool? Anytime you find something in the helicopter and you don't know what it is, look at the things that are attached to it. We have, there's a hose pipe going in here, and oh, there's a pipe coming out the bottom. Well, the pipe there comes along, and then it goes down here, and it comes down, and it goes into this thing. What's that?
Oil.
Oil. And there won't be very much on the stick because it leaks back, but yeah, that's the oil reservoir. So we've got oil coming in this way. And then we also have this, which comes down here and goes into, oh look, this hose right here, silver hose. And that silver hose goes into the bottom of the engine right there. That is the oil pump. That's what pumps the oil, puts the pressure through the engine and up into the transmission. All of the cooling oil lubricating oil in the transmission and the engine. It's all the same stuff. That helicopter has two separate reservoirs, different oil for the transmission than the engine. The R-44 has two separate reservoirs, two different kinds of oil. The Bell-47, very simple, early design. That oil goes in the engine and the transmission. So it goes from the pump through there, up, cool, back in, down to there. It runs from the bottom here through the big hose into the engine. The pump pushes it up. Return tubes for each cylinder. That's what these things are. And then it also goes up through a line into the transmission. So that cools the oil. And it does it by blowing air. There's like this, back and forth inside, where it gives it as much time as possible. And as the oil's going through, the air blows across it, takes the heat away. So when the engine's running, if you put your hand here, it feels very warm. And this catches some of that, and it goes through the red tube into the cabin. And this is cabin heating. And on this one, it only comes out on my side, so you're going to be cold and I'm going to be. There's the oil cooler. On this one, you can't see the cooler at all, because from in here, we can turn the heat on and off more or less by going like that. Okay, so now none of the heat's captured and it blows out. When we close it, it goes through into the cabin. But if you look back carefully, you can see behind it's the same thing. So if you're gonna fly in the wintertime, you wanna be in this aircraft and not in that one. And this one goes up and down. It does the same thing. Pin out, maybe. In the summertime, we fly like that. And it cools it. In the wintertime, you can change how much heat by putting the pin in different places, right to all the way down. What might be a problem if we had it like that? There you go. It might overheat. You might not get enough air to let the oil get cool enough. And going from winter into springtime, if it's been really cold, maybe, well, if you were in Terrace, it'd be like that. And when I flew in Manitoba, we had not only that closed, but we also had all of this closed in with panels to keep all of the heat in. So it's at minus 40. You need that. Okay. But in the springtime, if you go out and the temperature starts to get warm, you look inside and the temperature gauge is increasing. Uh-oh. Oh yeah, I forgot. Then we get out and change this, and then the temperature comes back down. Right now, it's just set halfway, so we're gonna leave it halfway. If you're on this aircraft, you wanna make sure that this is tight, because what you don't want is for this to come out in flight and go back and hit the tail rotor, and then we have a lot more problems than not enough heat. And then we start spinning around the circles. Attaching points for the gas tank. Okay. We're going to make sure that there's no cracks, that the strap is tight. Now this one, this just stops it from rubbing on the paint. So that's okay, we'll leave it like that. You can see places where the paint's chipped and cracked a little bit, but we want to make sure that the metal's not cracked. So looking through, this is a grounding strap, just for static electricity. Any guesses? Oh look, there's a hole in it.
Static.
It's a vent. If there was no vent, we filled this up with fuel, close the top, seal tight. As the fuel comes down, and there was no way for air to get in, it would create a vacuum inside. And the vacuum would actually crush the tank. It would crumple up. So this is a vent that allow air to come in and out of the tank. So if that's plugged up, this isn't going to vent properly, the fuel's not going to flow properly, and we're going to have damage. There's one in there, there's one on the other side. This box is where all of the very complicated Bell 47 electronics are stored. Computers, rate monitors, There are about four or five relays, old style relays that open and close. For battery relay, starter relay. So if something doesn't work inside electrically, we push the starter button, nothing happens. It might be because the starter relay is stuck. There are things that you can do to fix that. You're never going to have to do that, so I'm not going to tell you about it. It'll only get confusing. There's also a voltage regulator in there, so when the generator is running, if it's overcharging, usually it's because the voltage regulator has failed or the contacts are dirty. This is something that the engineers fix, so we just go find them. But that's what's in the box. That's where all the electronic parts are. This right here, little square box. I'm going to move the throttle in the collective, and I want you to watch that. Tell me what happens. Moving?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Collective up, collective down, throttle open, throttle closed. That's called the cam box. What it's supposed to do is it's supposed to add fuel by increasing the throttle when you lift the collective so that we don't have to do so much with our wrist. It doesn't work very well at all. Bell 47, we still have to move our wrist quite a bit. But that's what that box is for. It was designed to make it a little bit easier for the pilot. When we lift the collective, the pitch on the rotor blades increases, and it's harder to push through the air, and it tries to slow down. So we have to add more throttle. Bell decided that they would design a little cam inside so that when the collective came up, it automatically put some more throttle in for us, so we didn't have to move it quite so much. We've got all these hoses and things here. This is a hydraulic servo. Okay. One there, and there's one on the other side. I'm going to move the cyclic forwards and backwards, and I want you to tell me whether anything happens here. Oh, look. Now I'm going to move it side to side. Nothing happens. The other one's moving, but this one isn't. So fore and aft, back and forwards, is that servo. That's the fore and aft servo. Lateral, side to side, is the one on the other side. Do you really need to know that?
Really,
but it shows you that each servo has one job to do. This one makes it easy to move the cyclic this way. That one makes it easy to move the cyclic that way. And if I move the cyclic in a little bit of both directions, they both move. That's designed to make it easier to move the control. Hydraulic servo. It helps us with hydraulic pressure. We can turn it off and fly the helicopter just fine. It's still possible to move the controls. In the 76, when you guys get on the 76, you have two separate hydraulic systems, because if the hydraulics stop working, what happens? Oh yeah, and then you die. it doesn't work anymore. It won't fly. Because there's no direct control rods from the controls to the rotor head. And even if there were, it's so big that you couldn't move it. Too much pressure. But this one, we can fly with the hydraulics off. The collective, there's no hydraulic on this at all. Only on the cyclic, and it's just to make our job a little bit easier. So those servos all leak because where the piston goes up into the cylinder here, right? It's a little bit wet. There's a seal where it goes up and down. It has to be able to go smoothly. If the seal was really, really tight so that nothing could leak, it wouldn't move. Okay? So it has to be loose enough so that the piston can go up and down inside. So all of those seals will weep a little bit. And you can see on the threads here, there's some hydraulic that didn't get wiped off this morning. So it's normal to see hydraulic fluid here. And it will drip down. You can see on the cluster underneath here. Little bit. We have to keep that cleaned up every day, because if you don't clean it up, it's very dirty, sticky, and when things get dirty, we can't see underneath them, so you can't tell whether something's cracked or broken or not. Right? So we want to keep the aircraft as clean as we can by wiping down all that stuff that leaks. It's normal for it to leak. We just wipe it down. Now, if we come out in the morning and look, and there's a puddle this big underneath, and the aircraft flew yesterday, maybe we should find an engineer. Don't wipe the puddle up. Go find the engineer first and show him how much fluid leaked, because that's more than normal. If we see a couple of drops like that, well, that's normal. That's the way it comes out every day. And when you fly the same aircraft day after day, you get used to what happens with it, and you'll see. And you see the pulley right there in the center, where the belts go over the top, there's a lip on the bottom that you can put your fingers in. If you see any oil in there, that means it's coming out, that shaft, the output shaft seal is leaking, and that's a very bad thing. So if you see any oil when you look in there, go find an engineer, say, hey, what's going on? This is a vent, there's like a thermostat, like there is in a car radiator in here. Sometimes these have a tendency to leak, and it'll start to fill up with oil in there. Quite often, when things leak on these helicopters, if they're just coming out a little bit, we leave it. If that leaks a little tiny bit, it doesn't matter, we'll just keep it clean. If it comes out a lot, then we have to take it apart. So, straps are in good shape, the vent's on there, this is attached nicely, the rubber here. Shouldn't be big cracks, no chunks, no pieces missing. The bolts are tight again. Every place where you see a weld, you look to make sure that there's nothing cracked. And these do crack. It does happen. Right? Everything's moving all the time. It's not all that unusual to find that a crack has started. And when they do, we repair them. So on this particular helicopter, see, there's a tube, and then it looks like there's something on the outside of it, right there. That's a repair. That tube had a crack in it, and we got the helicopter welding man to come in, put the special doubling tube on the outside, and re-welded it and repaired the crack. So if you see something like that on one of these, you know that there's been a crack there and it's been repaired. Every place where all these pieces come together, right, like this, that's called a cluster, because two or three different pieces come together, and every one, when I look at it, top, bottom, inside, and out, and make sure that there's no cracks. If you see a spot, I don't think there's any on this, right, well, something like this. If you look at this, say, oh, it's cracked. Well, that actually is just paint. If it was the metal, cracked right through to the metal, probably we'd see some red, rusty color in there because the moisture's getting in and the metal's going to start to rust. If we're really not sure, go, wow, that wasn't there yesterday. Again, we'll go find the engineer. And if they can't tell for sure by looking, what they'll do is they'll take a file and they'll take the paint off and look at it to make sure that the metal's okay underneath. So we do that every place we find a weld, all the way around both sides, top and bottom, underneath. Working our way back, exhaust. We've got the exhaust manifold. We've got intake manifold. The intake manifold, the air comes in through this hose right here. There's a little scoop at the front.
Can I leave one more with you while I go on?
Absolutely, and there will be a test.
Oh, thanks.
So the air comes in, it comes down through the hose into there. That's where the air filter is. We're not going to open it, it's not serviceable by us. Every 50 hours, the engineers open it up and they take the filter out and clean it. Then the air goes from the filter through here into the carburetor. Okay? So through the pipe up into the carburetor. And oh, look where this comes from. Remember, the fuel comes from the bottom of the tanks. It's gravity flow. There's no pump. Through here, through the fuel filter, down through that line, and into the carburetor. So that's how the air and the fuel get into the engine. It's mixed, goes through the exhaust or intake manifold here, and then through these pipes into each cylinder. The spark plugs spark. The fuel and air ignite, they explode, the pistons go up and down. Actually here the pistons go back and forth like this. That turns the crankshaft, which turns that, which turns the big thing, and now we're flying. Pretty simple. The oil pump is in here, the oil filter is ups in there, and there's a lock wire that's got this nut locked onto the bottom. When we change the oil, they cut that wire, take the nut off, and the filter comes out. And it's not a paper filter like a car, it's a metal filter. So they look at it, clean it off, and then put it back in again. Okay. So that's the only oil pump on the aircraft. That's the only filter. And that's where the oil runs in and out. Transmission. Okay, so the engine, as we saw over there, we can see all the parts of the crankshaft in the middle when the pistons run, the crankshaft turns, it goes up into the transmission. Look. And the clutch sits inside of here and it's centrifugal, right? So when it starts to spin, these shoes come out and they push on the inside of here and that turns. And now we're flying again. Transmission turns, it turns the shaft, which turns the blades. Then we have to get the tail rotor to work. So the tail rotor, there's an output shaft, there's planetary gear, one's like this, the other one's like that, and it starts all of this spinning. So the shaft turns, goes back up through the tail rotor, and then it's got to get to another right angle there as it comes out, and then the tail rotor spins. All of this stuff has to be able to move. So it's on rubber here. And if you look at the bottom, we've got mounting one, two, three, and four on the other side. There's shafts and more rubber. That's called the sprag mount. And it allows the engine to move back and forth without going too far. You don't want it to go too far, but it has to move a bit. And this moves back and forth when we fly. And there's got to be some way that this can move without breaking the tail rotor drive shaft. So tail rotor drive shaft the short shaft here, is not completely tight. It moves back and forth like this a little bit. It has to move. If it didn't, if this moved, it'd go sproing and break, and that would be the end of it. These boots are full of grease. And inside there, right, like this again for gears, if they put too much grease in and this doesn't move at all, then we have a problem when the transmission and the engine mounts move. If, when we touch it, okay, we never try and move it this way, we don't try and move it up and down because it's going to break, only very carefully like this back and forth, and it should move a little bit. If it goes clunk, 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 and we hear metal on metal, that means there's no grease or not enough grease inside. And we go find an engineer and say, hey, oh, grease. And they'll fix that for us. Sometimes the boots get little holes in them. When this spins really, really fast, it'll throw grease out, and you'll see grease here, and here, and here, and there. If this one's leaking, you'll see grease on the inside. Okay, so you go do your walk around, and there's grease all over the side of the tank and here. That's because there's a little hole in this, and when it spins, it throws the grease up. So we wipe it off to keep it clean, and maybe mention to the engineer that there's a hole in it. If it's a pinhole, we just usually just leave it. If it gets a big tear where all the grease is going to come out, that's dangerous. We need the grease to lubricate that spline. So they'll put another one on. These are called hanger bearings. That's what supports the shaft as it goes back. They're full of grease. And they have on the front, okay? Dirty grease. Because it's sticking outside. When they grease this, they grease until clean grease comes out through that seal. Okay, so pump, 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 pump. And normally, it's that color. If it comes out and it's white, that means there's water in it. And that happens here all the time at this time of year. We go out flying, the rain comes in, it gets driven in, water gets into the grease. Water's not very good for grease, and if there's a lot of water, it doesn't do the job it's supposed to do. So we'll re-grease it. If it's raining really hard and we've been flying all day, we'll re-grease it, put more grease in. So this all gets kept clean, okay? Everything's wiped off. The shaft here is very, very, very thin. It's very strong, but it's very thin. If I take my ring and I go like that and scratch it, I've just turned it into junk. And it's thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars to replace it. So we never grab the shaft, never try and move it back and forth, up and down. And the only time you ever touch anything is here, just with your fingers like this, nice and gently, back and forth. That's the only thing you do. Mounting and welds. Okay? Again, it stays clean. It's easy to see whether there's a crack or not, so you shine your light on it, wipe it down. You got a couple of sets of cables. I'm going to move the tail rope nuts. Let's look at what cables. Okay, you see the pitch changing on the tail rotor? Mm-hmm. Moving back and forth. Now, let's look underneath the engine and see which set of cables are moving. Which ones are moving? So which ones were moving? Those guys in there. These cables are just wires spun together. And we need to make sure that they haven't started to come apart. So the way to do that is by running a rag along them. Because if there's a little wire sticking out, you will catch it. You can do it with your fingers if you want. It really hurts a lot. It's like getting a needle jammed into the end of your finger. Okay? Now, where do these wear out? They wear out underneath, right there. Okay? When they go back and forth in the pulley, that's where they usually wear out. So if we just look at it like this, we're never going to see the break underneath. So you move the pedals all the way and come and check, and then you move them all the way the other way and check again. The other set of cables are attached to the side plate. We move the side plate forward and back. Okay? You see them moving? The Bell 47 at cruise speed is quite a bit more flat because that is designed when we push the cyclic forward, it brings the tail back. Make it flat. That's the only thing that's there. So when we're checking the cables under the pulleys, you have to move the pedals and move the cyclic, and you get to see underneath. For the rest of it, we run the cables along. If there's a break in it, and we've got a couple of cables in the other room, and I can show you where they've started to come apart. On the turnbuckles here, you have to make sure that it's got lock wire. Okay? If that wire's not there, that can come apart. Comes apart, it's not going to work right anymore. These are used to adjust the tension to make them tighter or looser. So they all have to have lock wire. So you check that every day to make sure the wire is there. There's another one. That's got lock wire. Where they go through here, they all have rubber. And you notice this one, they move around a little bit. The rubber starts to get worn out because the cable rubs on the edge of it. That's okay if it's rubbing on the rubber grommet. We don't want it to rub on that. If it starts to rub on the metal, it's going to wear the cable out. So if we find that it's starting to rub on the metal, engineer, come and fix it for us. Okay? So all the way back. You guys are crazy! On the hanger bearings here, you notice all the grease nipples are all in exactly the same position. So when you look down, it makes a straight line. If one of these has come loose and has turned, you'll notice right away because this isn't pointing the same direction as all the rest. This will move. If it's over here, there's something wrong. So we work our way back, looking at all of those, looking at all the cracks, checking the cables. So, elevator. There's a spring so that if this cable breaks, this goes to a neutral position and stays there. I came back last summer and we had one break right here. This whole piece came off, so the cable was down like that. We didn't even know that it had broken until we came back and landed. You don't really feel any difference when you're flying, but that's what that spring is there for. It's designed to hold this in position so it doesn't bounce around too much when you're flying. This is called the vertical stabilizer. This works like the bottom of a sailboat. It helps to keep it straight when it starts to move through the air. Check for damage, check for loose rivets. We hold that together and try and move it. It should not move like this at all. And there shouldn't be any play back and forth this way. So this one, a little tiny bit, you can, if you look very carefully, you can see it moving. Okay. How do I know if that's too much ask the engineer. What am I checking? I'm checking to see if it's different than it was yesterday. Wow, that's quite a bit looser. It's really been getting loose for a week. I better go find an engineer and ask him. Okay, so lock wire is just weight, lead weights for balance. And each helicopter has a different amount. And if you look on here, the other one, they all have different amounts. So the way the helicopter figure out where the center of gravity is and that determines how much weight has to be back on the tail. Because when I sit up front, it really makes a difference. This is called the harp. This is to protect the tail rotor so it doesn't hit the ground. If we come in, the idea is the harp will hit the ground first and push it back up again, keeping the tail rotor away from damage. Tail rotor works pretty much the same as the main rotor. When we move the pedals, it moves the cables. The cables through the gears inside, in and out. These are pitch change links, just like we have on the main rotor. And that changes the pitch of the tail rotor blades. So these are really important. They all do that. This is not telling me anything about the condition. You will see people walk around and, oh yeah, that's okay. Yeah, that's okay. It doesn't tell you anything. We have to know whether or not the bearing inside is wearing out. So we hold the bolt like this, and then we move this up and down on the bolt, right? And that moves a little bit up and down, and then I try and move it this way, so forward and back, and there's no movement at all. This way we can take a little bit, this way much less. So if it's moving when we go like this, we'll go find an engineer. This end, hardly any movement at all. So what happens is these ends wear out first, and when this one gets worn too much, they turn it around, put it on here, put the other end out here. And then when they're both worn out, then we replace them. Okay. So these were just replaced. They're pretty good. This one as well. A little bit more movement there than there is here. Flapping, the tail rotor flaps back and forth just like the main rotor does. There's a stop right here that limits how far. That's the stop. So sometimes on a windy day, when we're sitting in the helicopter, as it slows down, you'll feel bong, bong, bong. That's this. The helicopter slows down, the wind allows it. It's not spinning fast enough to stay off the stop, and it'll bang back and forth. And that vibration goes all the way up through the tail rotor, and we'll hear it and feel it in the cabin. That's what it is. Okay. So we've got flapping in there. We've got pitch change, and it turns on these two bearings. Those are called feathering bearings, right? Where these bolts go through. Now, if I hold it against the stop like this, and I grab the blade here and try and turn it, it will tell me whether those bearings are getting loose or not. So that moves just a very, very, very small amount. And then I'll hold it against the stop there. This one moves a little bit more. Okay, so I'm trying to move it like. It's kind of hard to see, but if you look up on top, look, there's a hole in it. Is that ripped? Is there something wrong with it? Well, watch what happens when we move the tail rotor pedals. Gets bigger, gets smaller. Why is the hole in the top?
To allow the air to go in and out.
That's all.